Ja, velkommen alle sammen, og velkommen til siste økta nå på cupfinaleseminaret. Jeg sikker på dere alle har gjort et veldig godt valg med å komme her nå. Vi i alle fall utrolig glad for å få en sånn kapasitet som Siggi til å komme her. Så sitt tilbake og nyte presentasjonen. Her tror jeg det veldig mye gøy. Utrolig å få en sånn kaos som her kommer med et land med 330 000 innbyggere. De har klart å kvalifisere seg til EM. Og de har slått ut nasjoner som Nederland. Og det blir utrolig interessant å høre hva han har å fortelle her I dag. Så, Siggi, as I said, we're extremely happy that you're here with us today. And we, as you can see, a lot of people want to hear what you have to say. So the stage is yours.
Thank you. Does it sound okay? Do you hear me? Perfect. As you see, the topic is what explains the unbelievable success of Icelandic football. Maybe it's a little bit... can we fix the sound a little bit? I'll try to explain. We have about 75 minutes. I'll try to explain what lies behind the success. In my opinion, of course, there's maybe not just one or two reasons why Iceland is doing really well in football at the moment. But I'll try to explain the best way I can. There are many different reasons why, and I think I'll touch upon most of them in the presentation. And I hope, yeah, much better.
Better?
Well done. So, in the beginning maybe, just to compare it a little bit to Norway, the size of the population and so on, we have around 330,000 people in Iceland, and just over 20,000 players. And on the right side you can see the population of Norway, the number of players you have. It's a very similar percentage. 6.3% of Icelanders are registered players in football and 7.3% in Norway, according to the Norwegian FA. But might be a little bit closer. In Iceland we do not count the non-league. We have a non-league which counts between 1,000 and 2,000 players. So if we count them also, it's about the same percentage. But we'll talk a little bit about that later on. It also has about the same ratio of female players to male players. So the two countries are very similar in many ways. I've moved to Norway and I'm now the assistant coach at LSK, Lillestrøm. So over the last year, since January, I've experienced a little bit how the setup is in Norway with the youth training. And of course the first team training, I hope. And so I've been able maybe to compare it a little bit better than when I used to just live in Iceland and never lived in Norway. So I hope I can explain a little bit to you things that we've been discussing at our club, things that we want to improve at Lillestrøm. We're going to change the youth structure. We're going to make it hopefully better. But it's going to be based a lot on the Icelandic way of developing players. Maybe you find something interesting. Maybe you think, ah, that's not for me. And that's fine. I hope I can get you thinking a little bit about it. And you can decide for yourself what's good and what's not. We're in Lillestrøm, we're in the part of Akershus, Hobroklets, and Iceland is smaller than that, with fewer people, but we still have more people than Bergen, just to put it in perspective. What's been interesting to follow over the last few years is the progress of the men's national team. The men's national team was very close to making the World Cup, last World Cup. They got to the playoffs and played Croatia. Managed to get a draw in Iceland, but lost away, so they couldn't get into the World Cup, which was a big disappointment. But now, qualifying for the Euros in 2016, they've done extremely well. And the team just keeps getting better and better. And it's the best team we've ever had. And many of these players that are now in the full national team, they were in the under-21 final competition in Denmark, 2011. So they've been together now for many years, and the team is getting better and better and better. On the picture you see the president of the Icelandic Football Association, Geir Thorsteinsson, shaking hands with Lars Lagerbäck, the men's national team coach. He's from Sweden, I'm sure you know him. Next to him sitting is Heimir Hallgrímsson, who is also the men's national team coach. They coach the team together now. And the team has done extremely well. What's interesting, yes, Iceland qualified now for the Euros in the first time in their history, but what's interesting is the way they did it. They already qualified with two games left in the group. And they had some good teams in the group, like you see, and they've had some fantastic results. Beating Netherlands twice, beating Czech Republic, beating Turkey with a big win and so on. I think you can be lucky sometimes in football and get good results. Of course, maybe you need a little bit of luck. But when you get good results in many matches and through many years, you're a good team. And Iceland has a very good team at the moment. So that maybe has gained a lot of interest from newspapers or the media and coaches from around the world. To try to learn why is Iceland all of a sudden doing so well, because they've never qualified before. We played football over 100 years in Iceland, so there must be something that we're doing. And that's what maybe we're trying to answer a little bit today. What's also interesting is that the women's national team over the last few years has been doing better and better and better. They managed to qualify for the Euro 2009 and also Euro 2013, where they reached the quarterfinals. And they're ranked 19th now in the world. They've been as high as 15. And they also got silver medal at the Algarve Cup in 2011, which is one of the strongest friendly tournaments in the world in women's football. So the team is doing really, really well also. We have today in the group the women's national team coach of Iceland, Freyr. Can you raise your hand? So if you want to have a chat with him about the women's football in Iceland, he's the right person. So the women's team is doing extremely well, qualifying for the first time in 2009 also, like the men's team is doing now. So both of the teams are doing really well. When you look at the FIFA rankings, through the history of the FIFA rankings with the Icelandic men's national team, you can see that over the last 5 years or so, it's improved dramatically. It's gone up more than 100 places on the FIFA rankings list. And of course you need to also look at some time before that, what's been done, because the players that are now in the A national team, they've been developing for over a decade, 10, 12, 15 years and so on. So what have they been doing? When you compare it to Norway, Norway was ranked extremely high in the past, but maybe overall have been going down a little bit. Going up again now, which is good. The clubs are doing well in Norway. The league is good. A lot of good things going for Norwegian football. The women's national team is doing well. So I think there's no reason to panic. The Norwegian football is good, but we can always improve and become better. Here's a picture of a lot of Icelandic players, just to give you an overview of what Icelandic professional players are doing abroad. We have over 90 players playing professionally abroad, which is a lot for such a small country. The top left picture is Arnór Ingvi Traustason, who just became Swedish champion with Norrköping. He scored the goal and had an assist in the last match to guarantee the win. Then we have Matthias Vilhelmsson and Holmar Örn Eyjólfsson. They both played for Rosenborg. They were champions with Rosenborg. Next to them, you probably know that guy, Viðar Örn Kjartansson, played for Vålerenga, was the leading goal scorer in Tippeligaen last season with 25 goals in 29 matches. Alfred Finnbogason is top right. Alfred Finnbogason was a late developer, became an outstanding player maybe when he was 18, 19, but where some of the national team players have become fantastic when they're much younger, but he was a little bit late developer. But he just scored the goal against Arsenal the other day with Olympiacos in the Champions League. And he's been the leading goal scorer in the top league in Netherlands. What's interesting about these top players, that they're not, none of them are playing every match or playing regularly for the Icelandic national team. So even though they're doing extremely well at club level, they've struggled a little bit to get into the men's national team. That tells us that the team is quite strong. In the bottom here, you have Gudberg Gunnarsson, the goalkeeper for LSK, the Lillestrøm, who were Norwegian champions and are playing in the cup final. Just dropped out of the Champions League, closely. You have Holmfrid Magnusdóttir playing for Avaldsnes, Welsh national team player, both of them. And best goalkeeper in Norway this season, best attacker in Norway this season. Then you have Dagny Brynjarsdóttir, who was national champion in 2014 in college football in America, and then went to Bayern Munich and became champion of Germany. Next to her, you have Sara Björk Gunnarsdóttir, who is the captain of the Swedish champions, Rosengård. All of these players play for the A national team. This is what the Icelandic professional players are doing abroad, an example of the players that we have. I made this list earlier this year. It's not 100% updated. There have been a few changes because players are changing clubs all the time. But it just shows you that how many players we have playing abroad. 70 professional players in 14 countries. And the list keeps getting bigger and bigger. We also have 20 young players playing abroad. That are born 1996 or later. And every year young players are going from Iceland to clubs in England or Scandinavia or Netherlands. They are the popular countries to go and develop as players. So in total, 90 players. We had 13 players playing in Tippeliga this season. And then the head coach, Lillestrøm, is from Iceland, just like me, who's the assistant coach. So every year, you see Icelandic players playing in Tippeliga, and normally some of them are doing really well. Some of them have been sold to bigger clubs abroad. Matthias Wilhelmsson, for example, went from Start to Rosenborg this season. The goalkeeper of the Icelandic national team was not in Tippeliga, they got relegated, but he got sold. So Icelandic players are doing quite well in the league. People tend to look at just the men's national team, and that because they're doing really well, that's gaining a lot of attention. But if you look back for the last 8 years, we've reached 8 final tournaments with our national teams. So the men's under-17 national team has been there twice, the women's A national team twice, the women's under-19 has been there, men's under-21. Men's under-21 now is also top of the group, qualifying for the next Euros. They've managed to beat France and beat Ukraine away, so not in an easy group, but they're doing extremely well. They've also been to a playoff in 2014 for the Euros, so they're doing really well. The men's national team, of course, now for the first time, 2016, will be very exciting for Iceland. So all the national teams seem to be doing well. On this slide, we have pictures of a lot of Icelandic players. Top left, you probably don't know him unless, Teitur Þórðarson there at the back, he knows it. It's Ásgeir Sigurmundsson playing against Maradona. And many say Ásgeir Sigurmundsson is the best Icelandic player ever. He was voted best player in Germany in 1984. There's a legend in Icelandic football. Then you have Hermann Hreiðarsson, who at the time when he was playing in England, he was the Scandinavian player with most matches in the Premier League ever. Then you have Margrét Lára Viðarsdóttir, who has 102 A national team matches for Iceland and 75 goals, which is one of the best ratios you'll find in women's football. Her sister is playing for Kristianstad professionally. They both played there this season in Sweden. Thoran Ingi Valdemarsson played in Tippeligaen with Salzburg. Fandis Friðriksdóttir, she played in the Women's Top League in Norway and is a regular starter in the Icelandic national team. You have Gunnar Heiðar Þorvaldsson, who was a leading goal scorer in Sweden in 2005-2006. Birgir Kristinsson, who's played over 70 matches for Iceland as the goalkeeper. He's retired now. You have a national champion in college football, women's. And you have Tryggvi Guðmundsson, all-time leading goal scorer in the Icelandic league, who has scored 60 goals in Tippeligaen in 136 matches, playing for Tromsø and Stabæk. Why do I put all these players up? They all have one thing in common. They all grew up at the same club. They've all been developed at the same club. And the reason why it's interesting is because the whole town has only 4,200 people. So, and they were developed at IBV. I was coach last season, head coach of IBV in the men's top league, and just going to the place and living there for, I was there maybe 6-7 months. I saw that one age group, when you have so few people, 4,200, in one age group, you might only have 15 players. But yet they've managed through the last decades to create players that some say are the best players Iceland's ever had, and players playing in Tippeligaen for the national team and so on. So it tells us you don't need to be a big club, a huge club, to develop top players. So that's a lesson in player development. It's also that people spend a lot of time on talent identification. Where are the best talents? I'll have to pick the best players from the other clubs to come and play for my club. But I think the majority of your focus should be on player development, to develop the players that you have. Of course, you try to spot good talents and bring them into your club, but you don't have to be huge to create good players. There's another town in Iceland, Akranes, with 6,700 people. It's a little bit bigger, and you see they've been developing players also for decades, playing, going straight from Akranes to very good clubs abroad in many, many different countries. Some very good players there on the list. You probably have heard of a few of them. One of the worst ones was 99. It's a bad year for them. But here we also have an example of a club in Iceland, Breiðablik, who has the most registered participants. I think there's somewhere around 1,300-1,400 players there now at the club, at all age levels, both boys and girls. And Breiðablik has been probably the best club now in Iceland to develop players. So normally their best talents, they are sold to foreign clubs abroad. And they've been using the Icelandic way, which I'll talk a little bit about later on, what's typical of how they develop players. And with this strategy that they've used, they've developed players, 19 players in 8 years that have gone abroad to play professionally. Some of them here in Tippeligaen, some of them for bigger clubs, some of them playing in England, Spain, and so on. 12 of these players have already played for the A national team of Iceland. So they must be doing something right. And this slide comes from their head of youth, Dale Rapson. So, what's typical then of the Icelandic way? How do we do it? First of all, what's different from Iceland to Norway is we don't have volunteer coaches. We don't have parent coaches. All the coaches in Iceland get paid. It's a profession. It's looked at as a profession. You need coach education. Almost all of the coaches have coach education. So, no parent coaches, no volunteer coaches. All the coaches get paid. That means that when your kid, maybe 6 years old, goes and trains with the football club, you should expect from day one that the coach knows football, probably played football to a decent level himself, has coach education, and will start teaching technical skills from day one. And there's emphasis on teaching technical skills from day one in our youth training. I found I have found, of course, I have only a small view of Norwegian football development, player development, from living just almost 1 year now in Norway. But at Lillestrøm, we have a lot of parent coaches, a lot of volunteer coaches, and they're quite separate in what they're doing. So I coach the under 10, for example. Somebody coaches the under 10, and someone else coaches the under 12. And they don't communicate so much. That's just my group, and they're not working much together. We want to change that. Maybe it's different at your club, hopefully. But in Iceland, 90% of the coaches have coach education. That means they've gone to at least one weekend course, which is 26 hours, if I remember correctly. That's the minimum. And 90% of Icelandic coaches have that education. And they've experienced normally in playing football. In Iceland, what's different also from at least how we do it at Lillestrøm is that we have ability-based grouping. In Norwegian, you say differentiating. And I'll explain that a little bit better later on, what I mean by differentiating, because it might be that people look at it differently what differentiating is, but we think that's one of the key things to develop players in Iceland. A couple of years ago, this way of coaching was challenged in Iceland, and a lot of discussion, should we have ability-based grouping or should we have mixed grouping? Or more maybe the Norwegian style of coaching kids from age 6 to 12. So we discussed it a lot, we looked at research, we spoke to all the I spoke to all the technical directors of the Nordic football associations and so on. So we really thought about it, we really dived into it, and we still think this is the best way to coach players. You don't have to agree. We focus on developing all the players, not just the best ones. So there's a difference between differentiating and topping, if you call it that in Norway. So we focus on all the players. Because we only have 20,000, we have to develop all of them. Because some of them are early developers, and some of them are late developers, like I talked about Alfred Finnbogason, the striker from Olympiakos. He developed quite late, so we have to coach all of them. We have to give them all a chance to become better. We move our best players up an age group. So if you're too good for the age group you're coaching with, the training with, we move you up. And of course, that happens a lot in Norway as well. We encourage extra training. We might give the players homework. The Icelandic FA try to help the clubs in that way, which I'll explain a little bit better, by giving out a DVD to all the kids in Iceland that are training football to encourage extra training. Exactly this important point. Less girls can train with boys. And there are exceptions. Some clubs are not doing that. Some clubs are really focusing on that. But we found that some of our most successful players have been at small clubs. Not in Reykjavik, not the big area, but in smaller clubs where they had to play maybe more than one sport and train with boys, playing with an age group above, just to fill in the numbers, just like happened with IPV in Vestmanna. And these players, they maybe develop better leadership or more experience playing against better players and training with better players, so we recommend this. Best girls can train with boys. What's also different in Iceland is that the local town authorities, or the communes, like you say, in Norway, they really support the clubs. They normally pay for the football facilities. Of course, there's an exception to that, but we have great support from the communes that pay maybe for a football hall, they might pay for the AstroTurf pitch and so on, and then they hand out these facilities to the clubs and say, okay, you run the football practice, you run the club, and you run the facilities. But the facilities belong to the town authorities. I found in Norway, from what I've learned, of course you may be more expert on it than I am, that a lot of the money that the parents have to pay for their kids to train football goes towards paying for facilities. In Iceland, almost all the money that the parents pay for the kids to train football goes towards paying the coach's salary. That's a big difference between the two countries. We can discuss what's better. I think we're very lucky with that system. And then one other thing that I think is really important, and I'll talk to you a little bit more later on in the presentation, is that mentality, the Icelandic mentality. It's a good question if it exists or not. A lot of people seem to think it exists. I'm one of those people. I think there is something different there. Of course, we're generalizing over a whole country, a whole lot of players. But I think there's something there to be looked at. The Icelandic mentality, and we'll talk about that. Ability-based grouping, just to explain how we do it. So if you're in Iceland and your kid is training football, let's say there are 50 kids training in that age group, we will try to divide the players in training and in matches. So the best ones train together, the average players train together, and the worst players or the beginners, they train together. They might all do this at the same time, in the same hall, or on the same pitch, but the coach tries to structure the training in a way so you train with equals, players with equal ability. Why do we think this is important? Yes, we think if you don't do it this way, it's more challenging, more difficult for the coach to structure the training to help all the players become better. Because there might be a huge difference in ability from your best player who's maybe trained for 6-8 years, and you might just be, let's say 6 years, you're coaching 12-year-olds, and you have someone in the training who's just started playing football. So if you mix those together, we think in Iceland it's quite hard to teach them in the same football training, so everybody gets challenged enough. So we prefer to put the best ones together, the average players together, and the weaker players together. And in that way, you're playing against equals. In that way, you won't get big wins and big losses as much. I was shocked when I came to Norway to hear, there was a really good story, we have a physio at the club who is coaching youth players in one of the smaller clubs, not so far from Lillestrøm. And he said to me, yeah, I'm a coach, I'm a youth coach. We haven't lost a match for 2 years. So I said, wow, that's impressive. You have a good team, you must be a good coach. And then one day we played a match. And before the match, the players were making fun a little bit of the physio. So I said, well, what's going on? He said, we lost our first match today for 2 years. And I said, oh, I'm sorry to hear that. What was the score? It was 32-2. So he played against a team that scored 32 goals against 2. And that was shocking to me because in Iceland, this normally doesn't happen. You don't get these huge differences in ability because we think it's no good for the team that scored 32 goals. They're not going to get better. And those who only scored 2, I lost with a 30-goal difference playing football. I thought it was good, but I lost with 30 goals. We think that leads to drop out more. So we don't want this to happen. But of course, it might happen occasionally. So it's also really important that we educate the parents of the system, if you want to put that system in place. Maybe you have that system in place, I don't know. In Lillestrøm we don't, but we want to change it more towards doing this. One of the main criticisms I've heard of this system is that the friends are not playing together. Okay, you might have a girl who's really good and her best friend is very average or poor. And then maybe they're not always training together. And one of the reasons why kids want to train is to have fun and stay with friends and so on, play with friends. So this system, yes, it's focusing more on developing, making players good, but also I'm not saying that you can never change it. In Iceland it's typical, you might have occasionally sessions where you just put the friends together. But they all show up to the training together, they hang out after the training together, they go on trips together and so on to tournaments, but they might play with different teams in the tournament. So they play with teams that fits their ability. So you can decide for yourself with the two systems what you think is best. I've put here on the left the major reasons why kids participate in sport. And it's from sports psychologist Daniel Gould and Petlikoff from 1988, but the reasons why haven't changed so much through the years. These are the main reasons why kids train football. And if you think about the two systems, and you think what you think is better, you can just decide for yourself to improve skills. Is it better to have mixed grouping or ability-based grouping? To have fun? Can you have fun in both systems? Iceland has about the same number of players, percentage-wise, as Norway, yet we have two different systems. Yet we don't see in Iceland a lot of players dropping out because of the system. In a big research in Iceland of all sports, we found that over 90% of all kids in Iceland, they really enjoy their sport participation. So they're happy in the system. Can they be with friends in both systems? Can they experience excitement and thrill? Or do they lose with big numbers? We found also when you put players that have great ability, have trained maybe football 6 years, you put them with a beginner. Of course, if they play one against one, there will be a huge difference. The poor guy would never score a goal. If we put them together in a team, two against two, the good player might never pass it to the poor player. So he's not going to develop. So maybe I'm painting a dark picture here, but that's my personal opinion, and you, of course, decide what's good for you. And you can add different things here on the left when you weigh up the two different systems. What's important? What do you think is important when you develop youth players? So there are many different factors you can put in there, but think about it. One of the things that have changed dramatically, if you look at from age 2002 in Iceland, which I think is maybe the start of things changing for Iceland and the beginning of more focused development of players, there are two things that changed in a dramatic way in Iceland in 2002 and have been developing and getting better and better every year since then. Those two things are coach education and football facilities. And I'll explain with the coach education. Today we have 67.1% of all the coaches in Iceland, all levels, even the smallest grassroots clubs on the east or west coast of Iceland, they have a coaching license, the UEFA B license. 28%, just a little bit more than that, have the UEFA A license. 89.8% have completed at least one weekend course. So they are big numbers. When I started working for the Icelandic FA in 2002, my main job was to develop the coach education in the country. It was not approved by UEFA. We wanted to go into the UEFA convention of mutual coaching qualifications. So we had to change. We had some old an old system in place, which was very random. You might come to a course and learn something, and then you might come to the next course 2 years later and learn the same thing. So it was there was no technical director, there was no rhyme or reasoning to what was being done. So we had to organize that. We had to think what's important for coaches to learn. What do we want to teach the players? How do we give the coaches in Iceland the right tools to create good players? So my job was to develop the coach education, get it approved by UEFA as the UEFA B license, UEFA A license, and then we linked up with the English Football Association to do the pro license. What happened also was that the Icelandic FA decided with the coach education to make it as cheap as possible. They make absolutely no money on it. So that meant for the first few years, at least up until 2010, the UEFA B license in Iceland cost 3 or 4 times less than in Norway. So we made it really easy for coaches to come to the course. They could pay for it, but normally the clubs would pay for it. Over 90% of all the people that came to our courses, the clubs paid for their education. So we got a lot of people into the courses, and then what we saw then, there was maybe coaches even in the top league who hadn't been to a course for 20 years. All of a sudden, there were youth coaches at the club with more coach education than them. So they thought, hey, hang on a minute, I have to go and do my course, because it creates a little bit of pressure on them. So those people also came to the courses. When we saw that the people living in the on the East Coast, West Coast, and the North and so on, weren't coming to the courses, we brought the courses to them. So we just took all, gathered all the teachers, and went to North of Iceland to have a course. This we have been doing now since 2002. And for example, this year we had around 700 coaches, 770 coaches coming to a course, which seems tiny, very small compared to Norway. But the total number of coaches in Iceland that are active is only 630. And we reach over 700 in 1 year. So we reach more now in 1 year than 6 years. We did in 6 years' time before we started in 2002 to do the coach education. And we do that every year. So that's been a huge improvement. The other thing that happened, of course, were the facilities, and I'll come to those here. In January 2002, we only had one football hall in the whole country, five football turf pitches, AstroTurf, Kumspanagras, and seven mini pitches. The mini pitches are small AstroTurf pitches built on school grounds. And you have those, a lot of them in Norway, I know. So, this is 2002. I played in Iceland in 2002. I was Icelandic champion with KR Football Club in 2002 and 2003, but we trained on a dirt pitch, Vasidu Grus, on dirt pitch, I think, and then we would do the rest of the year when the football season was out. It's about 7 month pre-season in Iceland, very very long pre-season. We were doing running, strength training, maybe a little bit of indoor football on like a team handball pitch, because there were no football facilities. In 2002, this started to change, and every year more and more football halls came. And today, we have seven that are full size in the country, 12 that are smaller size. They're football halls, but not full size to play on, but good for training. 23 football turf pitches, 136 mini pitches. And we built them on school grounds to promote interest in football, but we have about 84 clubs in Iceland. 82 clubs we have. So you see, that's a huge improvement. Of course, one club doesn't get to use one hall by themselves. Like the teams in Reykjavik, they use it together. But what's important is that we use the football facilities for all age groups. Not just the first teams, but for the kids. So I have a 10-year-old daughter, she's playing football, has a lot of enthusiasm, she's playing for Ellis Corner. But she, when she was playing in Iceland last year, she was training three times a week in a football hall. So that's a totally different picture from when I was playing with the Icelandic champions, should have the best facilities in the country, so it's totally, totally different. So the facilities are different, the coach education is different. It's a huge revolution. Now you can play football all year in Iceland. In the past, you can only play 4 or 5 months. And this has been going on now for 13 years. So of course, those who benefit the most are the players that were young when they were 13 years ago, because now they're coming up to their national team, under 21 national team and so on. So that means they're technically better, more skillful, because they grew up playing football all year, so they can do a lot more technical and tactical training and so on, get better coaching. So that's a huge improvement for the football in the country. And maybe in the past, Iceland was just always underachieving because it didn't have winter facilities. They could only play football 4.5 months out of the year because of weather. So that's maybe one of the reasons we're doing better now as a football nation. For coach education, of course, it was great. Because it meant that we could do a lot more coach education courses and do stop and stand still and talk to the coaches. In the past, it was just always frozen, or very, very cold outside, snow on the pitch and so on. You couldn't really do it. So we have more know-how at the clubs now. Here's an example of how the commune can really help to develop football facilities and clubs. That's the Grindavík, they play in the second highest league in Iceland. Total population, 2,697 people, but you can almost fit all of them in a football stadium. And they also have a football hall. Of course, the companies, it's a fishing town, they have proportionally a lot of money, but they support the town. So you see fantastic football facilities at the club. Akranes, the club that was developed one player per year for 30 years, the list we had before, they have a huge grass pitches where you can train on. They have a nice stadium, and they have a full-size football hall. And what happens is that just somebody comes in the morning, opens the door, and then kids can go in and play and train all year from morning till evening if they want to. They're not being charged. Everybody in the town can use it. Old people go in the hall in the winter just to walk, because then it's not snowing on them and not as cold. But it's for the use of everybody in the commune. The reason why we have this support from the community is, or the local town authorities, communen, is because we think in Iceland sports are really important. Every year we do a big study in Iceland with all the young players, young students in schools in Iceland. We see from the research, we pretty much question, everybody comes to school one day, every year. We've done this for 20, 25 years. And we ask them, do you participate in sports? How many times a week do you train? Do you use drugs? Do you smoke? Do you use alcohol and so on? And the research has shown that kids that train sports, they feel better at school, they have higher grades, they have higher self-confidence, they're less likely to do drugs. We see all the benefits. And it's how we want to move as a country. It's also good for prevention and so on of diseases, to exercise. So it's important for the communes. They support that. In Iceland, we start very young to train. Maybe do that also in Norway. But these are typical number of sessions per week for kids to train. And of course, these can vary a lot. But this is the club training that you can have, how many times a week you train. Of course, in Iceland, we also have mandatory that you have to do physical education, sports in your school, with a physical education teacher. And then all children have to learn how to swim. So you have some other sports activities that maybe support the football. And what's changed over the last, 10, 12 years, is that clubs offer now more training maybe to the most promising players. So you might have special training sessions for those that have extra talent or are extra motivated or that just want to train extra. So they might show up before school in the morning, and then of course, just as in Norway, we have maybe a lot more private football going on now with private companies like Curver Coaching is now getting bigger in Iceland. Some smaller football some football academies are coming over, or coaches from foreign clubs are coming over to have the Ajax school or the Arsenal football school and so on, which is motivating for kids and more training and more football. Some of the schools offer, the secondary schools from age 16 to 19 or 20, they offer extra football as well. You can maybe train during school time, play football twice a week, three times a week, and then put football as a part of your education. You will actually get some credit for that football when you graduate, towards graduation. So, young player in Iceland, growing up, has so many opportunities to train a lot, learn a lot, become better, fantastic facilities, very good coaching, a lot of training sessions and so on. This is a slide that shows the age of the players at Breiðablik, which I said was maybe the best club now in developing young players in Iceland. How many times a week they train during the winter time? How many times a week during the summer or the football season? And how much the kids have to pay? These numbers are probably 1 year. They're 1 year old. It's from Daði Rapsson, the head of youth at Breiðablik. What's also interesting is that the local council or the commune, they pay money. For each kid that trains football, the club will get some money. So that money can go towards the salary of the coach. And it's not just football, it's team handball, it's basketball, it's if your kid wants to learn how to play a musical instrument or go to art school and so on, they can do that. And for each kid, they will pay around 215 euros. Almost all of the town authorities in Iceland do that. Even the very small communes, I would say almost all of them pay. They pay varying amounts. Some of them do it from age 6 to 12, or 6 to 15, or 6 to 18. But almost all of them do it. We think that's important. And that supports the football, of course. If you're a volunteer, as in Norway, you have an absolutely fantastic volunteer system with parents, with Dugnad, I've taken part in that. It's fantastic. It's something that Iceland can learn from Norway. Outstanding. We have volunteers in Iceland, but it's getting more and more difficult to get them. So clubs are now maybe doing ways, using different ways to get them involved. Maybe they'll decrease the number, the money that you have to pay if you volunteer, and so on. Most of it is spent on coaches' wages, but our experience, maybe my experience, limited experience from Norway, is a lot of the money is spent on facilities that the parents pay. In Iceland, we think extra training is important. So the Icelandic FA, we decided to do a DVD with 100 exercises, technical skill exercises, that we gave to all the kids that are training football in Iceland. We made 20,000 copies. And we thought this is important because we found that our best players, they normally train a lot outside of football. Maybe a little bit like Martin Ødegaard. So it's the that's the general idea. You see a small kid just with the ball, what can he do to get better? Or he might be with one friend, what can he do to get better? He doesn't have to be in a football hall. He can be in the garden at home, or in his gym class, or whatever. What kind of exercises can you do to get better? So they're simple exercises, and of course coaches can make use of that as well. But we also decided we didn't just want it to be a DVD that just kids have a look at and throw it away. So we tried to make it more valuable. And what we did, we got all the national team players, a national team for the men's and the women's, to help us, and the men's under 21 national team players. We distributed them all across the country. Many of them went back to their home club as big heroes and gave all the kids a DVD, hand to hand. Here, you go and watch the DVD and take good care of it. It will help you become a great player. And we thought in that way they would cherish it more. This DVD, I'm sure you can get it from the Icelandic FA. So I don't get 100 emails, I'll just write who you can write. Dagur at kse.is. When you write in, please say, I see you're very handsome. Can you say that? And please give me a DVD. He's a good friend. So, he's working in the coach education department at the Icelandic Cafe. I'm sure he will send you a DVD if you want to have a copy. It's not revolutionary, but it helps kids do extra training on their own. We also, when our under 21 national team, the A national team today, it was really good when they were under 21 in 2011 and qualified. It's the first time our under 21 national team qualified for Euros. So we started to look at that age group because we knew something special was going on. It's a team that beat Germany 4-1 in Iceland, beat Scotland twice in the playoff matches for the Euros. So we knew something's going on here. So I did a study on them to study their background in football. How did they develop? Can we learn something from it? Can we put it into our coach education? Can we put it into our player development? Can we let the coaches know in Iceland what we can learn from this golden generation? And this is what we found out. They typically started training while they were young. They played matches regularly above, hospitering. They did a lot of additional training. And various players said, I did very, very much. of additional training, and some of them said I did very much. Hardly anyone said I didn't do so much. So the extra training was really important. They also tried one or two other sports, and in Iceland we promote at the FA that kids should train more than one sport. We think that's good for their motor development, and they're less prone to injuries that way, we think. There's some research that shows that. So we encourage that, but we also encourage them one of those sports needs to be football. So they dropped out of these sports, normally from age 12 to 15. At age 16, everyone was just focusing on football. And then it becomes more specific. Now, the thing I want to mention also that hasn't been mentioned so many times, I've had these presentations in many different countries and many different times about Icelandic football, but one thing I haven't mentioned so much is the mentality of Icelandic players. So this is the first time maybe I'll talk a little bit about that. Because the more I think about it, and after I've moved to Norway, I've maybe opened my eyes a little bit more for that one part. When I coached the women's national team, I asked all the players to comment if they thought the mindset or mentality of Icelandic players was any different from Swedish players or Norwegian players or wherever they were playing. And I noticed almost all of them mentioned they thought it was different in some way. And they had difficulties describing it, but they all felt this way. So maybe that was maybe one of the things. The other thing is there's been too many comments from too many coaches that coach Icelandic players where they talk about the Icelandic mentality that their players are hardworking, they never give up, they typify professionalism at the club, they take extra good care of themselves, they learn the language when they go abroad. I wish I could do that. I'm still learning Norwegian. But these are all things that are interesting. The other thing is there are so many Icelandic players that have become captains of their clubs. You come from a small island, a small football nation. You go to a bigger club, sometimes a huge club, and they choose you to be the captain. Why? Why is that? Is it something about the mentality, the leadership? What is it? So I think before I go any further with this mentality thing, I want to show you a video clip. That I developed. But just when you see it, think about mentality in football, think how it relates to football, because it's not all about football. So you have to be open to it. Hope you enjoy it. It's about 3 minutes.
How is it for people in Norway to look at Iceland? They're doing better than Norway.
I think it's an inspiration. I think we have to look at Iceland. We're doing, you know, I work in the under-16s, but I know that Norwegian coaches in the Norwegian FA, we're really impressed by how many players you develop in this country. It's not a big country, but the mentality and of the players, fantastic. Everyone who comes abroad, they're... You have to be proud of them because you can see the attitude and they're so hard working and fantastic people. And for us in Norway, with quite a few more people, to see this work rate, I think it has to be maybe a wake-up call. It's about time we start rolling our sleeves up in Norway as well, because football is not just enjoying. It is hard work, but it's... The development coaches you have here and the setup and the system with how many players who can play football is impressive for us.
There's a famous quote from you about players' development being like the foundations of a house, with the head being the roof. I didn't really get it.
You didn't really get it? No. But it's in fact very simple. You build a player like you build a house, with a basement. You know, the basis of a player is the technique. You get that between 7 and 14 years of age. If you have no technical skill at 14, you can forget it. You will never be a football player.
I started studying kids and adults in all kinds of super challenging settings. And in every study, my question was, who is successful here and why? My research team and I went to West Point Military Academy. We tried to predict which cadets would stay in military training and which would drop out. We went to the National Spelling Bee and tried to predict which children would advance farthest in competition. We studied rookie teachers working in really tough neighborhoods, asking which teachers are still going to be here in teaching by the end of the school year. And of those, who will be the most effective at improving learning outcomes for their students? We partnered with private companies asking which of these salespeople is going to keep their jobs and who's going to earn the most money. In all those very different contexts, one characteristic emerged as a significant predictor of success. It was grit. Grit is passion and perseverance for very long-term goals. Grit is having stamina. Grit is sticking with your future, day in, day out, not just for the week, not just for the month, but for years, and working really hard to make that future a reality. So
saw a bit of the Icelandic mentality, but to continue with the presentation, I think you can divide all players, all football players, into three categories. Player number one is in football because it's fun, stay with friends maybe, enjoy it, it's an enjoyable activity. Maybe doesn't come all the time to training, is not really ambitious to become any better, but just trains football. Player number two wants to be better, wants to improve, does extra training, would like to improve and advance, and is willing to do some work to do that. And then you have player number three who just wants to be the best, will do anything to become the best player that he possibly can be. He or her will structure their life around football. These are the players that you almost have to say, you have to rest today because you cannot train so much. And these are the type 3 players. And I think these type 3 players, my personal opinion, and I cannot point out to any research at the moment, hopefully in the future, I think we have more types like that in Iceland, and also type 2 in the youth training, also how parents or the typical Icelander thinks about youth training, about their kids becoming better in football. They want them to be successful. Yes, they want them to enjoy it and all that at the same time, but they want them to be successful. So these are the three types. The woman you saw do a presentation on grit, she has this presentation on TED.com, you can look her up. It's a great presentation, it's not long, it's maybe 7 minutes. And her name is Angela Duckworth. And it's definitely worth it for you to see it. She is a professor in psychology from Pennsylvania University. And she also talks about how to develop grit, if you're interested in that, in your players. But she researched grit in all these different contexts. She was looking at people that are successful. And she found out that this one thing called grit helped them improve, helped them become successful. And this was a better indicator of success than talent. In many different contexts. So I'm starting to think, what if it's the same in football? What if it's the same in football? If we can use it in all these different contexts, can we use it in football? It's also good for kids that are not as good. less likely to drop out if they have grit. So it becomes a really, really good question, how do you develop grit? And just as she said, what is grit? That's her, how she explains it. It's passion and perseverance for very long-term goals. Something that's not for weeks or months, it's for years. And if you think about it, how do you see grit in football players, in young football players? They're the ones that maybe dream of reaching the national team or becoming a professional player abroad. Grit is stamina, sticking with your future and working really hard for years to make that future a reality. And if we think about it in football terms, it's the football player that wants to go really, really far, has so much passion for the sport. It's the type 3 that I spoke about. There's a research that was done in Iceland by Haukur Ingi Guðnason, who was a really good player and played for the national team, had a contract with Liverpool. I think he played one or two games for the first team. He's a psychologist today, and he did this research in 2006 on national team players. He took 116 players, and he was studying, is there any difference between those that played for the youth national teams and those who played for the youth national teams but didn't manage to go to the A national team. Is there any difference in those between players that played for the youth national teams but also made it to the A national team? Is there a difference in mentality? That was his study. He also looked at the difference between those who made it and played professionally abroad, which you had to be good to do it at that time. Of course, you have to also be good today, but he compared the professionals to the ones that didn't make it into professionalism abroad. He was asking this question, do the more successful players have better mental skills? And the tool he used is called OMSAT. It's the Ottawa Mental Skills Assessment Tool. You can see it in Norwegian. Of course, he used it in Icelandic. It might be available in Norwegian. But it's a self-assessment questionnaire, so it's not perfect research, but it can give you some hints about how the athletes think about themselves. The research showed that the A national team players had better mental skills than those who just played for the youth national team. It also showed that those who played professionally had better mental skills than the other groups who didn't make it as professional players abroad. The OMSAT scale, it also researches different categories. So you get those 48 questions into different categories. And the category that was showed the most difference in mental skills was commitment. It's a category called commitment. So it becomes interesting to see what types of questions or statements, because you have to do it. You get a statement and you have to say, do you very much agree to it or not agree to it at all? So these are the questions that Icelandic players scored really, really high on. And the best ones that came to Norway and Sweden and Denmark, England and so on and played, they scored higher than the ones that didn't make it from Iceland. So football is my whole life. I push hard even if it hurts. I'm willing to sacrifice most other things to excel in football. I'm determined to never let up or give up in football. They score high on these questions. I don't need someone to push me to practice and play hard. It's the type 3s that I say they don't need a coach. They're self-motivated. All the best players are self-motivated. There are some players now at Lillestrøm. We have the off-season. You can trust them. You know they will come in extremely fit. There are some other ones that you know they're not going to do much in the off-season. So, type 3s. I don't need someone to push me to practice and play hard. I give 100% effort in performing, and practicing and performing. Doesn't matter if my team is winning or losing. If your team is losing, you might see some players that go into a shell. They don't want the ball anymore. They don't want to know. They don't put in the effort. They don't have faith in themselves anymore. Then you have some other ones that just say, give me the ball. I'm going to score. I always want the ball. It's a mental skill. And the best Icelandic players score high on that. I feel more committed to improvement in my football than to anything else in my life. And what did we say about grit? Because these are questions on commitment. For me, they're really questions on grit. passion and perseverance for your long-term goals. I'm going to get there and not let nothing stand in my way. I'm going to become a professional player abroad. I'm going to play for the national team. And I think there are more players in Iceland, proportionally, aiming to get there than from what I see in the youth training and the first team training at the Lillestrøm. Maybe I'm wrong. Here's a quote. It's also interesting to see what coaches say. And here are a couple of quotes. Henrik Berg says, the mental attitude is the first thing you notice in Icelandic players. He talks about the Icelandic mentality. They're always giving the best effort. They work hard in training. They are mentally strong. They handle the pressure and act as true professionals. Another great coach, David Thorlason, sitting there at the back. Legend. He also coached in Iceland. Co-ed. And this is a quote from his time in Iceland, where he was commenting what he thought was different from coaching Icelandic players and the youth players in Iceland. He established the football academy at Co-ed football club. He says it's the dream of every Icelandic football player to become a professional abroad. And the dream carries them on. The Icelandic boys have a different attitude from the boys abroad. They are willing to work harder to succeed. And he's been coaching in many different clubs, played football around the world, national team coach of Estonia and so on. So it's an interesting quote as well. The captains that I talked about, you see the clubs that Icelandic players have been captains, and you start to think why. At the start of this season, there were two players in Tippeligaen that had two clubs in Tippeligaen who had Icelandic captains. Start and Víking. Start, changed their captain. They didn't win a game after that. No, I'm just kidding. So, sorry, that's your club. That's true. So, why is that? Isn't that a bit strange? Jim Collins. Jim Collins has wrote famous books, Good to Great. He's a professor at Stanford University who's dedicated his life on research on companies that are extremely successful, the most successful companies. Also looked at what makes them successful, what in the culture makes them successful, and especially the leaders of those companies. Why are they so special? Why are they more successful than others? So he's looking at many, many different fields, and he's saying the kind of commitment I find among the best performers across virtually every field is a single-minded passion, same as Angela Duckworth is talking about, passion. Passion for what they do, an unwavering desire for excellence in the way they work, and the way they think and the way they work. They're all talking about grit. So if you connect the dots, finally this research from 2006, where Iceland took all their best athletes and made them do questionnaires, asked them to do questionnaires. And they asked them question. This is one of the questions they asked. What are the most important qualities needed for top-class athletes? And we asked Eidur Johnson, who played for Barcelona, won the Champions League, played for Chelsea, England, champion of England, European champion in swimming, the team handball team, who later won the silver at the Olympics. Some very, very good top athletes in many different sports. And they listed four things that are most important. Mentality, mindset, which you could say is the overall mental skills that you have. Commitment to the sport. Self-confidence and self-discipline. To me, it's also saying grit. The thing is, do we teach our players mental skills? Or don't we? Because if the top athletes are saying, these are the most important things to develop, to become a really good football player, why aren't we listening? Or are we listening and teaching these things? And you start to think, as a football coach, how can I develop these things at my club, for my team, the athletes that I'm coaching? Or do I just think about what's going to be at the football session tomorrow, what am I going to do technically, tactically, physically, and ignore the psychological part, the mentality that you're coaching? We'll show you a little clip, again. How am I doing for time? Okay. It's my daughter. We're doing the, call it the Norwegian way of player development, one-on-one. We're in Marikollen in Reilingen, practicing juggling. It's 9:30 in the evening, nobody's there. And she wants to become better. When she started out, she could only do it two or three times. Now her record is 104. We're very proud. So, Embla is keeping the ball up, and in the end, she will drop it. And of course, she became extremely angry, but I've deleted that part, so you don't see it. So I'm trying to develop a football skill with her, help her to become better. But at the same time, it's a great opportunity for me as a coach or a parent to develop her mental skills. So she keeps saying when she drops the ball, "I can't do it, Dad." So I said, "If you say you can't do it, you probably can't. But if you say I can do it, you're more likely to be able to do it next time. It's practicing, you have to make mistakes on the way to become good." And then she said, because she likes to try sometimes to take the easy way out, she said, "Dad, can't you just show me what's the trick so you can juggle forever? There must be some trick to do it." So I said, "No, I don't know any trick to it. I don't think there is a trick." And then I said, "Yeah, I know what the trick is. The trick is look around you. How many players are on the football pitch training?" And she looked around and said, "There's nobody." So I said, "Yeah, that's probably the trick. You have to be willing to train when the others don't want to train. They're spending their time on something else. If you want to be good, you have to train more than the others, and we'll train smarter than the others, which I think is more important. It's not, that's maybe another thing with Norway. It's a lot of focus on quantity of training in Norway. At least when we came to Lillestrøm, we found pressure from fans, the board, everybody around, the players. We have to train a lot. We have to train more than everybody else. And I think that's good up to a point, but you also have to be aware of the quality of training. So we had, for example, one young player who played the match for LSK 2 in the second division, and the next day he was on the track, the running track, doing sprints. The day after the match, playing 90 minutes, got injured. Didn't tell us about it. So, because he thought, the more I train, the better I become. But you have to be strategic, you have to be clever. When to do the training, what type of training, and so on. So that's training smart. I think one of the reasons why Martin Ødegaard is where he's at today is because of his father. His father went out with him, I couldn't make it yesterday, I had training, but he had a presentation. Were you there? Anyone? Okay, I'm sure it was really interesting. So he was working a lot with his son, and I see that when I go to the pitch, there are some parents with the kids. We don't see that so much in Iceland. But I think it's a really good way, because when we do like technical skills training, like I do with my daughter, I can give her immediate feedback. And I think that's what's so important for Ødegaard, that his father can tell right away, "No, you're not doing it right. You have to correct the technique and do it a little bit better." Because there's a great guy called, sorry, I don't know if you can see this, Benjamin Bloom. Benjamin Bloom was an educational psychologist who did some groundbreaking research on how children learn in a school setting. But you can also think about it in football terms. What he found out, he looked at kids in the classroom, what improves their learning? How do they get higher grades? Is it homework? What happens if you let them do homework? Do the grades go up? What if you let them do homework and make sure that the teacher next day checks if they did the homework? Will that improve the grades even more? Does it matter how many people are in the classroom, how many students? All kinds of different things he looked at. And of course, decades of research in educational psychology is studying the same things. But what he found out was the most important factor. Do you know what it is? The most effective way to learn was that he found one-to-one learning. If you have one instructor per one learner, that's the most effective way. But of course you can't do that all the time, it's very expensive. So he created a smart way of getting around it, but still getting, he called it mastery teaching, I think. But the one-on-one thing is really important. If you think about any skill, juggling with a ball, playing the piano, whatever. Let's just say playing the piano. You don't know how to play the piano, you're a kid, and you want to learn how to play it. It's complicated, it's a big instrument, a lot of notes. What's the best way to learn it? Some people sit down and practice playing on the piano themselves forever. So they're self-learned. And some of the very good musicians have learned that way. But I think there's a way to learn it quicker and better and more effectively. And that is, yes, you can go to a group class where 10 kids play the piano and one teacher. It's just, think about it in football terms. Or you can do it one-on-one. And you have a teacher who knows how to play the piano. He sees immediately when you do something wrong. He can give you corrective feedback. He can motivate you, and so on. Help with your learning, and you learn much quicker that way. Much quicker. So, these are maybe all things to think about when developing players. But back to presentation. You still say I have time, or are you bored? Gylfi Sigurðsson, I just want to name an example. I only got a couple of more slides. Gylfi Sigurðsson is the type 3 player. He's the best player Iceland has today. He's playing for Swansea, the Premier League in England. Free kick specialist. Normally say two stories about Gylfi. One is, I had an interview with him when we did the DVD, the technical skills DVD. So I asked him, Gylfi, why are you so good in playing football? It's a very simple question, but maybe a question we don't ask our best athletes so often. And he said, for me, it's just been work since I was maybe 10 years old. I've had this rule of doing extra training before training or after training. I stay 15 minutes longer. And I practice free kicks, corners, shooting, passing. 15 minutes. And you might think, okay, 15 minutes, that's not a whole lot of work. I'll move this a little bit. So 15 minutes of work, not so much. So 15 minutes, you maybe do that on average 6 times a week. That gives you an hour and a half of training. So you've done an hour and a half of training a week, that means you do 6 hours in a month. It means you do 72 hours a year. Sorry, my handwriting is not very good. That means you do 720 hours over 10 years. He's done it longer than that. So let's say maybe he's up to 1,000 hours, just to have a number. If you look at the research of Antes Eriksson, I think he was a professor at Florida State University, but he came up with his theory of to be really good at something, to become a professional player, or a professional chess player, or outstanding in whatever you do, you have to train for 10,000 hours. And of course it's not that you have to train for 9,999 hours and you're not good, and then 1 hour you become good. Of course, it moves up over time. You become progressively better when you train. You shouldn't take that literally, 10,000 hours, but it shows that you have to train a lot. And by training just 15 minutes extra, you can get a lot of extra time. Gylfi is, when you describe him as a player, he's a free kick specialist. He scored some fantastic goals from free kicks. He was early taking free kicks for his team. Now the other thing I wanted to, that brings me to the other story, trains more than the others. Maybe that's why he's one of the reasons why he's better. The other story is when I did my A license in Iceland as a coach, I went with the under 18 national team to Czech Republic to a tournament of 8 teams. We played 3 matches. I had to be in control of the team 1 match, and then I was assistant coach for the other matches. Did some training sessions, did my practical exam with the group. Gilby was one of the players. So there was one training where we were playing a lot of games in 1 week, I think 3 matches in 1 week. So we had one training where we said, egen training, eller frivillig training. You can go out on the pitch and train if you want, or you can rest today, depending on how you feel, because we're playing a lot of matches. So we asked the group how many wanted to come out and train. How many do you think came? How many came to the extra training? Everybody. That's fantastic. Everybody came to the extra training. So we were there, and I was with the coach, Guðni Kjartansson. He said to me, we're just going to take a very, very easy training. Let's just practice on free kicks. Okay, great. So we had the defensive wall, goalkeeper, free kick. And the best player Iceland had at that moment is the captain of the Icelandic national team today, Aron Einar Gunnarsson. And he was built like he is today, extremely strong, fit. He took long throw-ins, he took the free kicks, he took the penalties. He was outstanding. Best player in the tournament for me, of all the countries we played against. So he was really good. The second best was probably Gilby. Clever, not so fast, but clever with the ball. Good technical skills, good passing, great fighting spirit, will to win. But as we're standing there in the training, I'm watching Aron taking all these free kicks, and some were good, some were bad, some were average, some went to the wall. And somebody knocks on my shoulder. So I have a look, and it's Gilby. And Gilby says, can I do the free kicks? I'm really good at taking free kicks. I'm practicing free kicks all the time. So I thought, wow, he's got confidence to do that, to ask the national team coach if he can go and take the free kicks. So I said, Guðni, he said, okay, give the text on free kicks. Yeah, no problem, Gilby, you can try it out. So he takes free kicks. It takes maybe 7-8 free kicks. And I had been a professional player in England, Belgium, played in Iceland with a lot of good players. Best free kicks I ever saw. It was all over the wall, into the top corner, into the far, striking it hard. Fantastic, absolutely fantastic free kicks. And what we saw, the quality, first thing Guðni said was, of course, Gilby, you just do the free kicks in the match tomorrow. And since then, he's been doing all the free kicks normally for all his clubs. So one thing is he practiced a lot, he developed the skill, which is one thing. The other thing is he had the confidence to say, coach, let me do the free kicks. That's another skill, that's called confidence. And we have to develop both. We cannot just develop, tell young players today, try to be really good at taking free kicks or shooting like Gilby. We also have to teach them the mental skills, develop them that way. This is a summary slide. It's my last slide. It's what we've talked about. So you can read through it. It's a summary of the situation in Iceland. It's just, in my opinion, working for Lillestrøm and helping with the youth department there, I'm coaching in the academy as well. From what I see, Norway, and I'm generalizing, so don't take it personally, it seems to me that Norway is very focused on bredde fotball, which is good for kids 6 to 12 years old. It's fantastic. We also do that in Iceland. Well, we do try to do it at the same time as putting a focus on developing players. And I think there's an ethical question there. It is that some kids are lucky that they get a parent coach in Norway that knows football, is interested in football, comes to the courses, gets his education, and then he doesn't have to get paid. It's not about getting paid. It's great if you have that passion and you want to be a good coach. But there are some kids that are not that lucky. And they have another parent that didn't play football, not interested in doing, just doing it because he has to do it. And he tries to do a decent job. But they're not going to develop the same way. And they might be lucky and have a great coach from age 6 to 12. And then be picked up by a bigger club like LSK or any of the bigger clubs, typically again. Or they might be really unlucky and have a bad coach until they're 12. And what happens then? You saw what Arsene Wenger said. From age 17 to 14, you have to develop technical skills. That's the age you should really focus on developing technical skills. And if you don't have a good coach that can help you, because you can get, yes, you can get drills to do. I can get the drills from the website or from Norwegian FA or whatever. It's not the same as coaching. The drills are a tool to help you. The coaching part is seeing, that's a mistake he's doing, I can improve it a little bit. So you step into the exercise and you help the player become better. You meet the player at his or her ability level and coach them. That's how they get better, giving them feedback. We have some coaches in Iceland that I call them traffic wardens. They make the coaching 50 players, they're just dealing with traffic. Play 5 against 5 here, you do these drills, you do these drills and so on. You might have a young assistant. That's totally different from coaching. Because when you do coaching, you have to step into the exercise and help the players improve and notice what he's doing wrong and know what's the next step that he needs to take to get better. I think everybody that plays football, starts playing football from young age, should have the opportunity to become an elite player later on if he or she wants to. I think the Icelandic system helps build foundation, so you have a technical foundation. Of course, it's to varying degrees, but we try to do that. When you're age 12, 13, then you can go and take the next step and decide, I want to become now Tippeligaen player, or I want to be play for the national team and so on. Then you have the opportunity to do that. If you've had a bad coach for 6 years who didn't coach the technical skills, you're in trouble. Because it's tough to learn when you're older. You have to use that window of opportunity to develop technical skills when you're young. So it becomes an ethical question. Do we teach the players the right skills? Does everybody have a chance to become elite? We have a player in LSK called Erling Knutsson. He had his best season this season, striker. Great athlete, fantastic attitude. Nobody works harder than him. But one thing is lacking in his game. It's called technical skills. And it's because he was 15 or something when he started to play football. So I'm thinking, where would Erling Knutsson play today if he had fantastic technical skills when he decided to become an elite player at age 15 with his work rate, his work ethic, his athleticism and so on? That's the question. We have these players also in Iceland. I'm sure Freyr would say, who has the A national team, one of the best players that we have ever had, or might be the best player, is Sara Björk Gunnarsdóttir, the captain of Rosenborg. One thing may be missing from her game, technical skills. She has all the other qualities. Nobody works harder, nobody is more professional, nobody's more fit, she wins all the fitness tests, fantastic attitude. But we hope, of course, that we can develop players like Sara, but to develop players like her that have technical skills. That's what we aim to do. So that was the overview. That was my presentation. We have some Icelanders in the group. If you're from Iceland, can you please raise your hand? Because people might want to ask you questions about Icelandic football. I'm glad Peter raised his hand. He's still Icelandic. So and I'll be around a little bit as well if you want to have us questions. I'm not sure, do they get a copy of the presentation or they can... Shall I? Yeah, you can. If you want a copy, you can write me an email. My email is up there, and I can send you a copy of the presentation. I have no problem doing that. It's just sharing a good message. Don't believe in secrets in football. So hopefully you gain something from the presentation. You don't have to agree to it. Maybe I was too direct. I don't know. I have my opinions. We all do. But I hope you maybe get 2 or 3 good things from the presentation that can help you become a little bit better in what you're doing. Or maybe you saw, this is definitely not how I want to do it. Then you've still learned from the presentation. Questions or stuff? All the time, maybe?
Yeah, not too much, so that's great.
Yeah.
Siggi, thank you very much for your... fantastic presentation. I know that I really appreciate it, and most of the people here also appreciate it. I noticed that you study a lot of people during, you know, to find your vision. So I, on behalf of Telefrenica, you know, we have a little gift for you. So we hope that, you know, talk about leadership.
Yeah, great.
And one of the greatest leadership men in football is Sir Alex Ferguson. So I hope you can enjoy it. And great. Again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Folkens, som han sa, hvis det noen som har noen spørsmål, så blir han litt igjen til. Hvis ikke, så det pizza ut I sportsbaren, så håper vi alle har hatt det bra, og så møtes vi igjen I morgen klokka 10.